Hello guys and welcome to Invested. So the whole textile industry is seeing strong business momentum due to multiple tailwinds. One stock that we like here is Philatex, which is a manufacturer of polyester yarn. So in this video, we'll see why this so-called boring commodity business could be a good investment at this stage. Now, textiles can broadly be divided into natural fibers and man-made fibers. Cotton is a natural fiber and polyester is man-made. And in this video, we'll be talking about polyester. But first, let's understand the value chain to understand what is yarn. So the value chain begins with PTA and MEG, which are crude derivatives. These are the basic raw materials used to produce PET or commonly called polyester. Then PET in the form of pellets or chips are melted, extruded and spun into yarn and then into fabrics. Now, there's a lot more to the process like dyes, additive, etc. But this is a simplified version. Finally, the clothing industry cuts and sews the fabric into garments. Now, looking at the value chain, you can understand that if the same garments see good demand, then fabric sees good demand and then yarn sees good demand. Now, in any commodity business, it's important to understand the supply-demand scenario. So let's look at the demand first. So globally, the demand for yarn is increasing at about 3 to 3.5 million tons every year. Now, China isn't adding capacity like it used to. Even though India is number two, China is about 8 times the capacity in man-made fibers. So even if India, Vietnam, Indonesia, Bangladesh want to, they can't fulfill the global demand because China is not adding capacity like it used to. And the important thing to note here is that because textiles is a labor intensive sector, there's a limit to how much Bangladesh, Vietnam and Indonesia can grow. India with its huge population can take advantage of this. And even locally, the supply won't match with demand for the next 3-4 years at least. We'll see how. The expansion happening in fabrics and garments is way more than what's happening at yarn. So demand will be way better than supply. Now let's look at the supply side. So we talked about PTA being a key raw material for yarn. MEG is not a problem because it's mostly imported. Now PTA capacity is just enough for current yarn makers in the country, right? And there's no PTA plant expected till FY24. Moreover, about 5% to say 7% of domestic yarn capacity has been wiped off due to a fire at one of Philatex's competitor's plant. And that will take about 18 months to get commissioned. But even if it does, it won't really matter because demand is so strong that it will absorb the supply by the time it's online. Okay, so now let's look at the industry tailwinds. Because in any commodity play, this is a must. So first we have the China factor. Now, Indian textile sector has been at a cost disadvantage against Chinese for a very, very long time. But what's happening recently over the recent years is that wages in China have been rising. And textiles, after all, is a labor-intensive sector. Secondly, during this pandemic, a lot of global brands have realized that it is risky to depend on one single country. So India is being looked as an alternative source. This is not only for yarn, but also for fabrics and garments. And a less appreciated factor is that China itself is vacating the space because they are increasingly becoming a developed economy. And like any developed economy, they're shifting the focus from being a mass producer of commodity goods to a manufacturer of high value or specialized goods. Okay, so now let's see the government initiatives, right? So the government has clearly realized the importance of the textile industry because India is currently facing a major employment crisis, unemployment crisis. It's the worst it's been in decades. And textiles being the second biggest employer can solve that problem to a large extent. It's labor intensive and skills are easily replicated. So let's see what all have they done so far. Right, so there was an anti-dumping duty on PTA, the key raw material, last year budget, that's been abolished. Then budget 2021, they announced a scheme to set up 7 mega textile parks. So they're going to create the infrastructure for it. Thirdly, the government has been discouraging Chinese products. So China was dumping a lot of yarn and a lot more fabric through Bangladesh, which is now reduced to a large extent because of increased import duty. So local fabric manufacturers are seeing good demand, due to which local yarn manufacturers are seeing good demand. And lastly, there's the PLI scheme. So the details of PLI scheme have not been finalized yet, but in its current form, it benefits garments and fabric manufacturers. But indirectly, it also benefits Filatex because demand for yarn increases. Now, there's a future trigger. This is a long pending demand for correcting the inverted GST structure. Basically, one GST structure for the entire textile chain, right from raw material to the garment. Now, uniform GST rate across the whole value chain will accelerate growth. And mostly this will benefit your small units in the downstream industries because that eases the working capital stress on them. So the intent is definitely there. So let's see what happens here. Now, another trend that's been seen over the last decade is that the whole textile industry has been shifting from natural to man-made fiber. So currently the ratio of MMF to natural is about 70-30 globally. In fact, over the last 10 years, 95% of fiber demand has been met by MMF, and polyester is about 80% of MMF. So the natural fibers have contributed 5%. So it's not like cotton isn't growing, but the cotton supply is not increasing in line with the overall fiber demand. India's case, the ratio is 55 to 45, and MMF is increasing because there's no scope to increase cotton. See, cotton requires a lot of water and cultivable land, and both these things are in short supply. And one more thing is that cotton is cheaper than natural fibers, and these days, to be honest, you can barely tell the difference. Now, one of the tools that helps an investor with industry structure is Porter's FIFOs. Now, for those of you who don't know what this is, it's a very simple yet powerful tool to understand any business. More specifically, it tells you how these five forces can affect your profitability. And the good part about doing this exercise is it helps you frame questions. So let's look at all these five forces. So in the center, you have your competitive rivalry, which tells you the nature of competition. In our case, Filatex has five major peers, and together these peers account for 70% of industry capacity, which means it's a relatively consolidated industry. As a thumb rule, the more consolidated an industry, the more power the players have. So let's look at to the left. Here we see bargaining power of suppliers. So Reliance and Indian Oil are the two large suppliers which supply the raw material PTA, which means these guys have pricing power. Now to the right, we have the buyers. In our case, this will be fabric manufacturers. This part of the value chain is very fragmented because there are a lot of small fabric manufacturers. And now, because of higher import duty, Chinese fabric isn't cheap anymore. So this benefits Filatex. On the top, we can see threat of new entrants. This is also low because the incumbents have long-standing relationship with suppliers and they can get preference in terms of supply. To the bottom, we see threat of substitutes. Now, this is the most difficult part to assess in any business because, as they say, risk is in the future and you can't predict the future. So, you'll have to keep your eyes open for this. So, Kodak didn't know that digital camera will end its dominance, right? Cable TV didn't see Netflix coming. So, one will have to learn to live with uncertainty here. Now, guys, on your screen, you can see the major products and the revenue contribution mentioned next to them. Now, we've already seen that PTA and MEG are used to make polyester chips. These polyester or PET chips are then melted and drawn into fiber. Now, PET chips can be converted into POY, which is an intermediary product, which is then either sold or can be used to make DTY. You can't make DTY directly from polyester chips. However, FDY, which you see towards your right, that can be directly made from PET chips. Now, even here you have like bright and semi-dull or different variants, but we are not going to get into all that. The key thing to know here is that both DTY and FTY are considered value added because they can be used directly to make fabric and have higher margin than POY or polyester chips. Now, value added used to be 10% in FY13. Today, it's like 80%. And this is only going to improve, and so will margins. Now, this is the most interesting part of this presentation: recycled polyester. So world over, there's a lot of talk about sustainability of textiles. There's a need to reduce the carbon footprint. So the consumption of textiles over the years has gone up, but the longevity of clothing has declined. Now, this is partly because of this whole fast fashion culture. All this has led to an increase in global textile waste, but only 1% of this textile waste is recycled. Now, one way of recycling is mechanical recycling, which a lot of companies are doing. But the problem here is that it's unable to effectively remove the colors and other contaminants from the polyester, thus resulting in lower quality end products. So you can't use it for manufacturing textile. In chemical recycling, however, the textile is first cut into pieces, then it's submerged in a chemical solution for depolymerization with some specific catalyst. The monomers can be purified and repolymerized, which gives you PET pellets of the same quality as virgin polyester. In other words, chemical recycling is nothing but converting the waste back to raw material and then cleaning off all the impurities and converting it back to polyester. So it's as good as virgin polyester. And very few companies in the world are currently doing this. Most companies that we looked at are startups with capacities between 10 to 50 tons per day, not more than that. Philatex is setting up 100 tons per day capacity. So if they can pull this off, it could change the fortunes of this company, because the demand for this recycled polyester is very high and there's hardly any supplies. Brands like Nike, Patagonia, Zara, Uniqlo, they're all willing to pay a huge premium for this. And Philatex claims that this product will give them 30% EBITDA margins. Now, this is at least a 30% plus ROC business, and they have applied for a global patent. So they are doing a capex of about 250 crores, but it won't get commissioned before calendar year 2023. So I would wait for the next con call to get more details on this project. Now let's see the growth drivers here. Minor growth drivers, but important nonetheless. So they've set up a product development team with the sole purpose to develop niche products. Now a lot of these are currently imported. They don't contribute much to revenues right now because it's in early stages. Because in textiles, what happens is the approval process takes time, because first you send the samples to the fabric manufacturer, he approves them, then the garment manufacturer has to approve. So the company is focused on researching and adding new filaments to the product portfolio, and this should increase margins going forward. One interesting fact here is that India's share currently is as low as 5% compared to China's share of 38%. Even smaller players like Vietnam and Bangladesh have a share of 3%, right? So exports is definitely an opportunity. Currently, exports is just 12 to 14% of their revenues, but exports is mostly value added, and margins in export are better. So exports, because it's a focus area for them, should also help margins. Then they have done a lot of capex over the last 5 years. In fact, capacity has more than doubled. So this year also they're doing a capex of 175 crores, but mostly they're adding texturizing lines and debottlenecking. So which should result in an addition of 100 tons per day of POY and DTY. And this will be operative by first quarter of FY23. Lastly, the company is setting up a captive power plant of 30 megawatts at the Dahej plant. Now, this will help them reduce power cost by 45 to 50 crores. So there are a lot of things they're doing internally to help boost the margins here. Okay, so now let's look at the financials. So even though the sector wasn't having the best days, These guys have done pretty well over the last few years, right? Debt has come down to 0.7. EBITDA has grown from 87 to 347 in the last 5 years, right? That's like a 31% CAGR. Margins last year were at 16%. This is despite having a washout Q1. So going forward, the management has indicated that they should be able to do 18% EBITDA margins, and they should be able to grow the top line by 50%. So financially, they seem to be doing all the right things, right? Even the working capital days have come down drastically over the last 5 years. So it looks like they are doing a good job financially. Now let's have a look at the risks. So volatility in raw materials. Now, the major raw material, PTA and MEG, are crude oil derivatives. So the company's inability to pass on any hike can negatively affect the margins. Secondly, you have your foreign exchange risk. Now, because export is a focus area of future growth, any strengthening of the Indian currency can negatively impact FIL's competitiveness compared to its international peers. Thirdly, you have your pledging of shares. Now, promoter holding is pledged to about 36%, but this pledging is on account of secondary collateral given to the bank. If they continue this performance financially, they can renegotiate with the lenders and reduce the pledge. So we'll wait for the next con call to get more details on this. Largely, labor is always a problem in this industry, right? If we have a third wave, we might see labor moving back to the villages. So here's our take on Philetex. So this year, they should be able to grow their EBITDA by 50% at least, with margins of 18%. And when we say this, we are being very conservative. So we have a small allocation here because what we are most interested is in the recycled yarn business. So when we get more details about that plan, we may increase our allocation. But even if you leave that aside, given the focus on increasing margins, this tight supply-demand dynamics, we can expect the return ratios to improve from here. So even at current levels, it does look very interesting, but as an investor, please do your own research and then take a call. So guys, if you liked our content, do comment and share this video. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next week.